Hi, can you train multiple ways a command with e-collar? Example, recall stim on verse one big correction with high distractions. I want to proof my commands are on high distractions and build speed. Take care.
So what you're going to do is this. The way we train, so teach. The way we teach obedience is with a lower level on the remote collar, pressure on, pressure off theory. It's called CS, continuous stim, every single time. Then we do something called NCS, which is, you can call it non-compliant stim, okay? Which means if the dog doesn't listen, they get the lower level stim applied back on. It's sort of like, hey, buddy, you remember? Like, this is what you're supposed to be doing. After a couple hundred more times of that, now you go to punishment. Call it correction, call it punishment, whatever word you're comfortable with. That is a momentary high historically. Historically, that's higher level, momentary. And then now what they're trying to do is avoid the correction. So then your dog is starting to become more compliant to avoid the correction. And that's a very good way to train. It's a good incentive because they know it, because it's fair, because they know it. And you do proof your dog. So today I started doing one-on-ones again today. I think you might have posted up some photos.
Zoe.
So Zoe posted up some photos of me today working with a client. It's a client that's already been through a boarding train. So I'm doing more human training than anything. But there's at one point where the dog is in place. And if you're not familiar with place, it's a dog sitting on a dog bed. It knows the word place means go to that bed and lie down. It knows the word break means now you can come off. Or if I recalled it, it can come off. So anything else I do, it shouldn't leave. So what did I do? I got 3 feet in front of it, got down on my hands and knees, and went, hi, sweetheart, how are you? Hi, honey. I did that. And guess what the dog did? It came towards me. I said, no, high-level remotes. Now, it's fair to do that. Why is it fair? It's a trained dog. It already knows place, and it knows break. But we call it dummy-proofing, or real-world training, or how to make sure your dog behaves when assholes approach your dog. So now I did it again. The dog goes, I ain't moving. You're looking pretty stupid there, Jeff, on your hands and knees making kissy noises at me. I'm looking pretty fucking cool right now. That's what the dog was saying to me. And I was saying, you know, I'm really glad this isn't on video because you're fucking right. Next.
I actually got it on video.
Cool. We're live. Now we're live. Boom. We're here. We're live. How's everyone doing? Good.
I can stop making that face when the show starts.
Every week. What day of the week is today?
I don't know. Wednesday?
Good Wednesday, everybody. Hey, everybody. How are you? It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training, and this is Joelle. This is the What Would Jeff Do show. I think we're at episode number 606. And this is the way it works. It's a 90-minute show. It's a Q&A show. You ask questions. Joelle reads the questions. A lot of people are like, well, how do I ask the questions? Type the questions into your little comment box at the bottom of yours. It says, add a comment. That's where you type it in. There's a dollar sign there. If you want to, you can hit the dollar sign, and you can do something called a top chat. What happens is your question goes to the top of the queue. We answer it right away. Also, it's a great way for YouTube to help out young creators putting out free content, which is what we do. I also do something called Jeff Gellman Seminars. Jeff Gellman Seminars is a worldwide seminar series. We're doing 25 to 28 of them in 2020. Go to Jeff Gellman Seminars to find all of the different cities that we're doing. This weekend, we're doing Sharon Springs, New York. So Sharon Springs, New York is good. So for all the folks in all of New York, okay, Montreal, Toronto, come on down. Vermont, New Hampshire, Maine, come on down. All right. Yeah. So you get Massachusetts, you know, come on up. So, you know, there's a lot of opportunity there for a lot of people. It's a wonderful seminar. After that, we're going to Chicago. After Chicago, we go to Austin, Texas. Sorry, Houston. Sorry, San Antonio. Sorry, Dallas. I'm not doing you in 2019. But come to Austin. And then after that, we head to Oahu. Go to Oahu. Now, if you go to jeffgelmanseminars.com on Oahu, you'll see some special pricing over there. What I did was, it's the only seminar series in 2019 that I'm offering some special pricing on to help some folks out of the in the island of Oahu. So that the seminars and the Q&A show are problem solving. Literally, how do I stop? How do I stop? How do I stop? So we specialize in dog aggression, reactivity, lots of anxiety. Obviously, every bad behavior known to dog, we specialize in. We also have a training center, which is what we're sitting in now. And the training center is, we specialize in mostly board and train. I would say 90% of our business is board and train, 4 to 6 week board and train. And that's everything from happy-go-lucky dogs that need basic on-leash and off-leash obedience to rehabilitating aggression. That is a more, that's about 95% yes, 5% no. So we food train dogs, we use our daily food, we clicker train, we use a reward-based training system as well. But on this show, we talk a lot about punishment. Punishment is an unemotional, non-emotional, showing no emotion protocol. And what you're doing is you're just, matter of fact, like, don't do that. So people need to learn how to properly apply a punisher to their dog. There is a proper way to do it. Timing being the most important, and usually most people are underwhelming their dog. So there's a timing issue and an underwhelming issue. So we're going to talk a lot about that. And here we go.
Here we go, 999 Top Chat from Michelle. I heard pretty terrible things about you, but the more I watch, the more I like you. I bonked one dog just one time. That day, my entire pack of three dogs were on their best behavior for the entire day.
So, Michelle, congratulations for your success. So this is the thing. Some horrific things are said about me. We were just talking about that, actually. We were just talking, actually, about making a podcast, trying to help my haters out a little bit and showing them that they're actually not hurting me, that they're hurting themselves. But there are horrific things that are said about me. Everything from I'm a pedophile to a rapist to an animal abuser. I mean, could you imagine that? Like that's, and I get the screenshots. So, and I see a lot of that stuff. So what it's just interesting to me that more reveals the person that's posting it than it reveals me, obviously. So that's just the way things are. That's just how some people are. Let them be like that. Let them be like that. But for some reason, people keep coming to our seminars. We have a 2-month waiting list. We've got a growing audience. The people that actually meet me in person think much differently from what they've heard. So obviously, and you are watching the show right now. So next.
Melissa, good evening, Jeff and Joelle. Hey, Melissa.
Hey, Melissa, how are you? Thanks.
Beverly, I volunteer at a shelter where people bring their dogs to meet possible adoptees. What should the protocol be that offers the best outcome?
I can't help you with that because I don't like the way they do it because everything's done usually on a leash. I think it's really hard. So I'm the wrong guy to ask. I think it's really hard for a dog to come into a shelter and meet a potential adopter dog. The best outcome would be they get along. But how about if they don't get along? That doesn't mean they won't get along outside the shelter. So it's hard. It's really, really hard. I don't have a good answer for you on that one. Next.
Kyle. Hi, guys. Yesterday, my 10-month-old GSD was nipped on the leg by another dog, and then he reacted for the first time. He didn't attack, just warned off.
Good.
Then today, he was being pestered by an off-leash lurcher. He growled to warn off.
Good.
When a dog he knows ran up behind him, which he then reacted and bit the other dog's face, drawing blood.
Yep. So what happened was, all of that's predictable. All of that's normal. The last one is not acceptable. That's why it's your job to keep dogs away from your dog. That's why it's your job. That's why we kick dogs that are off-leash that approach our dogs. Next.
Sage Paw, what do you think about letting a dog correct a puppy? I saw someone do this. The dog was getting stressed out because the puppy wasn't responding to its correction anyway.
Well, dogs get stressed out in general. As far as another dog correcting another dog, what's it for? And are they good puppy raisers? Is the dog a good puppy raiser? There's some really bad dogs that are not good puppy raisers. Uma, which was one of my dogs, was a great puppy raiser. So it also depends. I prefer to do the correcting myself. But you get a good, I mean, if you watch, there's a great video out there of a lab.
Oh, that golden retriever.
Her golden retriever and her puppies. Ooh, yeah. She does a really good job correcting her dogs.
Lays down the law.
Yeah, a really good job. So most of nature's fucked up. Nature's dangerous. Nature doesn't give a shit. But nature's pretty cool to observe. Mm-hmm. Next.
It's Zims. Hi, J&J. I'm new here and I love your methods. Makes so much sense. I adopted a 7-month-old chihuahua who was high-strung and reactive, but most especially dog-aggressive. I know she needs a leader. Where, how to begin?
Okay. Number one, thanks for joining us. As far as being a leader, you said the word. Leader, not boss. Leader. Okay? So, lead your dog. So, where do you begin? Cut down on affection and lead your dog. So, take a leadership role. Massive amounts of structure. Massive amounts of accountability. No free roaming. Hold the dog accountable. Be proactive with your training. Correct, as a matter of fact, for things that are not acceptable. Play with your dog. Fair amount of affection, but not overly amount of affection. So love and affection never fixed much of anything. It sure as hell didn't fix aggression. Love and affection is probably one of the number one reasons why dogs end up rehomed, because they get way too much and not enough of the other stuff that I mentioned. Next.
Sonia, my dog whines excessively when we go to the groomer. No matter how many corrections I give the prong, nothing works. Makes me not want to go at all until she learns better.
How about this? Take your dog to the groomer, drop your dog off, and leave. Next.
Hi, y'all. Oh, LG. Hi, y'all. My dog is in heat. My female has taken some steps back in training. She lunges at a loose dog today, and she's just freaked out in general. Should I avoid walking her till heat's over?
She's in heat. Yeah. Have you never dealt with females menstruating before?
Maybe not.
Okay. Shit gets real.
Really real.
You stay away from them. You try not to talk with them.
Can't give your dog a
And you sure as fuck don't argue with them. All right? Because you'll find out if they carry or not real quick. Next.
Christine. Watched the stop jumping videos yesterday and used the technique on my 80-pound Mal. No more punching me in the jaw. Thanks.
Yep. It works. Guys, I don't give out information. I don't make videos unless they work. You don't have to agree with them, but they work. So if you're trying other things that work, do those things. But if it takes you 7 months and we did it in 7 minutes, I would ask, do you think you're growing your angel wings? No, you're not. You're not being nicer. You kept your dog suspended in pain and discomfort for 6 extra months. But if you're not able to fix it, and you object to how I do things, that's on you, right? Isn't that on you? It's like, why wouldn't you want that fixed? So sometimes people, I understand ideologies, but we're talking about the life or death of a dog, at least with the dogs that we work with. But jumping on a human, you'd want to stop that in 3 seconds, which you did. So I can get a dog, I shouldn't say I. Any decent dog trainer can get a dog to stop jumping quicker than they can teach the dog to sit. There's that. Next.
LG, she's been a freaked out dog since 6 weeks old. We work hard, but it's been more difficult since starting a new job. Her walks are super early or late, less distractions to practice with lately. It's tough.
Yep. 6 weeks old is also too early to get a dog. So I don't know if you actually got the dog at 6 weeks, but that's a little bit early. The dog missed some important socialization time, but what's done is done. You can possibly recoup from that. So massive socialization, again, more leadership, more structure, tighten down on things, hold your dog accountability. You're going to see the same message for everything because, notice how I didn't say exercise your dog and train your dog more obedience. Because none of those matter when it comes to stuff like this. Should you exercise your dog? Of course you could. Of course you should. Should you train your dog in obedience? Of course you should. But the other stuff is more important. And this line that keeps being fed to people about like exercise your, like a tired dog is a happy dog. No, a tired dog is now going to be ready to go the next morning and cause all kinds of fucking chaos unless you actually train. Next.
Kristen, good evening, J&J from Madison, Wisconsin. Love yous.
Hey, love yous too, love Madison.
Love yous twos. The noble dog, what do you do to prevent chargebacks on your board and trains? I trained a dog up to the desired satisfaction and they did a chargeback. How do you prevent?
So, Grant, for some reason, buddy, all of your questions are about people being unhappy with your services, people not paying their credit card bills, people doing chargebacks, you struggling on closing sales. There seems to be an underlining theme here, buddy. There seems to be an underlining theme. So what I would do is I would do something called 100% responsibility, and I would look from within and realize in every one of these situations, who's there? Who's at the scene of the crime? All of these different clients, and then there's you. I say this with love and affection, and I'm saying this as somebody who pays me a lot of money to mentor them, which you're not doing, but I'm saying somebody would literally pay me lots of money to give them this realization. So it's not always what they want to hear, but what it is I care so much that I actually want you to win. But what I'm going to do is give you the information that allows you to win. And I think I tapped on it right there a little bit. So how do you prevent that? Number one, first evaluate whether you're doing a good job or not. Have somebody else evaluate you on that one. Number two, pre-qualify your clients to make sure you have the same level of expectation and you're bringing on the right clients. Number three, have really good human skills to make sure that you're able to pass on the knowledge that you've trained the dog, because we are in the human training business, not the dog training business. Okay. But I would own 100% of that. If any of my employees are not doing a good job, it's my fault. And this is the reason why. I hired them. Therefore, I let them in the door. Number two, if they're not doing a good job, I should be either training them or find someone that can train them to have them do a good job. Number three, if they're not doing a good job, why are they still working here? So it all comes back to me. So if you haven't seen my comments, whenever anybody gives me praise, I pass it on to the staff. They're doing all the hard work. I'm just the guy with a big mouth. It's a common line that I use, and I mean that with sincerity, but I will take all the blame. So if you love our company, it's my staff. If you hate our company, it's me. And I will own that forever. So there's just a couple of tidbits of information for not just for you, but for some of my fellow business owners. That's my mantra right there. Next.
Whew. $10 top chat from Robin. Another happy walk today on a busy beach boardwalk, prong layered with remote, heavy traffic, lots of dogs and kids, bikes, etc. He was so well behaved. Thank you so much for the tools and instructions.
Robin, where's the I believe you. Show me the video, hon. Robin, set up your iPhone on a tripod in front of you, and I want to see you. I believe you. It's not because I don't believe you, but I want to see this. I want everybody that's struggling out there, I want them to see this, because I want them to feel how you feel, and that's what I want for everybody. It's the best feeling in the world, isn't it, Robin? Mm-hmm. And people that don't struggle, I don't know if you get it or not. Until you've struggled with a dog, you take it for granted.
Yeah.
You take it for granted. Next.
Michelle, good evening, Jeff, Joelle, and Melissa.
Hey, Michelle. Hey, how are you? You can say hi to Cass, too. Cass is here. She's our Canadian intern. Bronwyn is our next intern. She's from Canada, too. I think 2020, we're only doing Canadian interns. Yeah. After that, we've got another Canadian from Vancouver. From Vancouver. So I think we're booked up in 2020 with a bunch of Canadians.
Up through June, yeah.
Yeah. Let's do, what country should we do in 2021? I don't know.
We'll get a theme.
We'll get a theme going.
Joe, hi, can you train multiple ways a command with e-collar? Example, recall, stim, on, versus one big correction with high distractions. I want to proof my commands are on high distractions and build speed. Take care.
So what you're going to do is this. The way we teach obedience is with a lower level on the remote collar, pressure on, pressure off theory. It's called CS, continuous stim, every single time. Then we do something called NCS, which is, you can call it non-compliant stim, okay? Which means if the dog doesn't listen, they get the lower level stim applied back on. It's sort of like, hey, buddy, you remember? Like, this is what you're supposed to be doing. After a couple hundred more times of that, now you go to punishment. Call it correction, call it punishment, whatever word you're comfortable with. That is a momentary high historically. Historically, that's higher level, momentary. And then now what they're trying to do is avoid the correction. So then your dog is starting to become more compliant to avoid the correction. And that's a very good way to train. It's a big, it's a good incentive because they know, because it's fair because they know it. And you do proof your dog. So today I started doing one-on-ones again today. I think you might have posted up some photos.
Zoe.
So Zoe posted up some photos of me today working with a client. It's a client that's already been through a boarding train. So I'm doing more human training than anything. But there's at one point where the dog is in place. And if you're not familiar with place, it's a dog sitting on a dog bed. It knows the word place means go to that bed and lie down. It knows the word break means now you can come off. Or if I recalled it, it can come off. So anything else I do, it shouldn't leave. So what did I do? I got 3 feet in front of it, got down on my hands and knees, and went, hi, sweetheart, how are you? Hi, honey. I did that. And guess what the dog did? It came towards me. I said, no, high-level remotes. Now, it's fair to do that. Why is it fair? It's a trained dog. It's a trained dog. It already knows place and it knows break. But we call it dummy proofing or real world training or how to make sure your dog behaves when assholes approach your dog. So now I did it again. The dog goes, I ain't moving. You're looking pretty stupid there, Jeff, on your hands and knees making kissing noises at me. I'm looking pretty fucking cool right now. That's what the dog was saying to me. And I was saying, you know, I'm really glad this isn't on video because you're fucking right. Next.
I actually got it on video.
Cool.
Karen GSD lover. Good evening, Jeff and Joel. Hi, Karen.
We just pulled from the security cameras too. Next.
Jose. Hey, Jeff. I have a 5-month-old male GSD. Could I start introducing the e-collar?
Absolutely. You can start at 14 weeks old. Next.
The Noble Dogs, why did you decide to use PayPal as your processor? Don't they charge you 3%?
They do, but I'm in the service-oriented business. If you're worried about 3%, you're in the wrong business. So who charges less? And what do they charge? 1.4%? If I go out of business because of 1.4%, I'm in the wrong business. 1.4% over the course of a month is what? How much is that? I mean, I can do the math and tell you how much it is. So will I ever reevaluate my PayPal processor? I've thought about it. And I've also thought about, I use Eventbrite for my 28 seminars. So I use Eventbrite as the ticket seller for, it's a ticket seller automator for my seminar series. And they also charge as well. And I've thought about actually looking for a new one of those as well. So now I'm at a point where I'm doing a considerable revenue, so I'm looking to generate more revenue and also reduce expenses because what I'm doing is I'm increasing my payroll. So I've already started increasing my payroll, and then in 2020 I'm going to be increasing my payroll even more. Therefore, the payroll's got to come from somewhere, so it can come from increased sales or reduced expenses or a combination of both. So that's what I'm going to do. Because right now, Joelle just hired another 20-hour a week person to her social media team. So she has 4 people on her team. So her budget of her payroll has gone up, and the money's got to come from somewhere because all of this content we produce is free. So we're spending more money now producing more free content. Yeah. So now we have somebody making 10 to 15 videos a week now for free, even more. So now if you jump on TikTok, you'll probably see some of the same videos, but you'll see some new videos on TikTok. Even if it's me talking to the camera, there is a cost to that. It's usually my sleep. So this morning I was up at, what, 2:38 or 2 o'clock or something?
I don't know.
I was up at 2 o'clock.
You also put that it was Tuesday, and it's freaking Wednesday.
Well, maybe it was, I thought it was Tuesday still. Next.
Erica, how do I begin e-collar training for leash reactivity? Start with basic pressure, on-off recall?
For reactivity, you can start with, if you directly want to attack leash reactivity, bonk your dog. Watch the video on bicycle reactivity that we put up. Bonk your dog. Start with there. And then you can use the remote to have a conversation with your dog. Next.
Julia's gallery. Just saying hello, spending a night listening while photo and video editing.
Awesome.
I'm in for Chicago. If there's an opening, my dog needs, no, I need guidance. No one else has been able to help.
So go to jeffgellmanseminars.com. Chicago's coming up in 2 weeks. Audit spots will not sell out. It's a pretty big venue. Working spots historically always do. I don't know if it's sold out or not. Even if only audit spots are available, please go to audit spots. Please buy an audit spot. You will learn a lot and your life will change. Next.
Debbie, my 8-month-old puppy pees when she sees my mother or granddaughter.
Okay. So don't invite them over the house anymore. Next.
Don't be snarky.
Leave the baked goods on the front porch and have them leave.
She needs help.
What's the question again?
Peeing. Excitement peeing. You should know. You okay. Fucking do it all the time.
Just when I see you, baby. Okay.
I make a lot of men piss themselves.
Shit.
It's one of my talents.
There's a wet spot. Oh, that's right. I just got a lap dance. Okay. So.
What?
It's a.
That's disgusting.
It's a strip club joke. Back in the adult days when I used to work at the strip clubs, trust me, the strippers are just as grossed out as the dudes were. I know. So what you're going to do is this, is teach your dog place. Teach your dog to lie down in place. At the beginning, here I am talking about never keep your dog under threshold, push your dog over threshold. In fact, we just put out a video on that, right? This is one instance where for a couple of weeks, I want to keep your dog below threshold and I want to start creating new muscle memory for the dog that it doesn't get excited when it sees grandma and granddaughter. And then you got to do grandma-granddaughter training saying, when you come in, I want you to be calm right now. You have to do that for a little bit. We got to give the dog, we have to have the dog win. I want this dog to win. So, I mean, you're not going to correct the dog. So I want the dog to win. Next.
Oh, that was very good advice. Pull that clip, Melissa. That was good.
And the rest of my advice sucks?
Well, usually, like,
you never compliment me on my advice.
You don't do, like, pee advice. You're usually, like...
I don't have good pee advice. I'm not.
That was good, though.
But I'm not the guy that, like, how do I house break my dog? I don't know. Watch a fucking video. It's like, that's not my specialty. So nervous, fearful, anxious pee, we just put them through our system. Mm-hmm. And they end up stopping doing it.
But a lot of it is the way we interact with the dog.
Right. But this is a different situation altogether as well because they come over once in a while.
Yeah.
So it's
But grandma and who?
Granddaughter.
They need to just ignore the dog too. Like human training.
For now.
For now.
For now. Yeah.
Erica, I bonked one of my dogs and he's been great ever since. My Jack Russell, however, barks constantly. He doesn't care when I do it to him.
So you're possibly underwhelming your dog. Also, I mean, just remember... Even though it's a Jack Russell and it's small, you can bonk extremely hard. Most people underwhelm their bonking. Next.
Christine,
hold on 1 second. I'm sorry. Also, timing. I want you to bonk that dog. This is what I want you to do. What's the dog bonk? When does the dog bark? Every time somebody comes to the door, my dog goes nuts. Okay, great. Put your dog on a leash. Stand 5 feet from the door. Okay? Have the bonker ready. Look at your dog. Have the dog a little bit in front of you. Just look and watch. Wait until all of a sudden that dog's ears go up a tiny bit, just the tiniest bit, or goes into some sort of arousal like, did I just hear something outside? No. Bonk. There you go. Next.
Christine. I was definitely underwhelming my dogs before I found you. I try to remember that when I get stressed in a situation.
Two things. Work on your stress. Three, and also, yes, you're probably underwhelming your dog. Next.
Cheyenne and Zeke, it's Wednesday already. LOL, the week's been going by so fast lately.
Yes, you're the second person who's reminded me it's Wednesday.
Yeah.
Yes.
Laura, how do you...
But hold on here 1 second. The week's not going by so fast.
I think so.
Because there's no such things as weekends. Next.
Ooh. Mm-hmm. Laura, how do you reintroduce female dogs who were separated due to a fight?
Good luck.
Good luck.
Good luck. Seriously. Those are the worst fights ever. I can't tell you how to do that through a 30-second snarky in between the wet spot jokes Skype. What is this called? YouTube Live.
Oh, it's an ambulance. I'm like, is there a dog howling?
No, it's an ambulance outside.
Got it.
So what you're going to do is very carefully. So I don't know your skill set. I don't know their behavior. Muzzles are probably going to be involved. So are leashes. This is the advice I can give you right now. Work on the walk and work on place duration by each other and put them on tie backs. Next.
Keaton, hey, y'all. Jeff, we exchanged an email or two about me going to the Austin seminar. I didn't hear back and have since sent a follow-up email.
Sorry, Keaton. I wasn't sure what it is. Please keep in mind how many emails a day I get and PMs and DMs I get. I don't know what it was. If you're looking for, I don't know. I'll be there. I'll be in Austin. Next.
Bill. Hey, Jeff and Joe. I can't thank you enough. The relationship with my dog has improved so greatly these past few weeks.
Awesome.
I love how you get right to business and don't beat around the bush when it comes to training. I feel like with your attitude, you'd be great at anything you do. And thank God it's dog training.
Thank you. I think my first 12 wives will disagree with that. But I think the thing is that life is short. Information is being put out there that is false. Owners are struggling. I only care about your success, which doesn't mean I don't care about your feelings, but I care about your success more. Sometimes the truth is hard to hear. If somebody's offended by my words, I'm not talking offensively, so that's on them. And it just goes to show the more structured, firmer, consequential you are with your dog, the better your relationship actually is. And believe it or not, if you do this anywhere from, say, 1 to 3 years old, you still have got 10 years of wonderful life where you can kick some major ass. But if you do this at 7 years old, it's not too late. Do you know a lot of people, we should probably do a Q&A on this. We really stopped. We haven't had time to do, I don't even know what it's called anymore.
The JJ tip of the day.
Tip of the day.
I know, we've not.
We should probably do that. You want to do maybe we should probably do a quick one on, for TikTok, we have 60 seconds. We should probably do a rapid fire one. You know, that could be a TikTok thing we can do.
Sure. On what? Where are you going with this?
But this tip of the day was, what was I talking about before I talked about this?
I have no idea. You try doing his video editing, you guys.
What was the
He goes from one thing to another.
What was the subject? What was the question?
I don't even know.
That's what it was. That's what I was going to talk about. Some people, you know, I get emails often. My dog is 1 year old. Is it too late to train?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I get that a lot.
Yeah.
It's like, one? Are you serious? Mm-hmm. Did you hear that from somebody? Like, did somebody tell you that?
Right.
That would be horrific if somebody was told that. Your dog's too old to train. At one? My gosh.
We have a 9-year-old board and train right now.
I mean, a real service dog is not started sometimes in their task until 15 or 18 months.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes.
Yeah.
I mean, they're still getting training, but it's theoretically never too old to train a dog. And if they're dead, they do downstays with head down.
You're sick.
Next.
$4.99 top chat from the Noble Dogs. Have you ever had a illegitimate chargeback? What safety measures did you put in place with your contract to prevent further issues?
Grant, no, I haven't. I don't deal with these issues. So I don't have any safety measures. I'm not getting any chargebacks. I wouldn't put any safety measures in place at all. I'm just not getting them. I'm not getting them. There was someone that didn't go to one of my seminars, and my seminars are no refunds, and it says it in two or three places. And they tried to do a chargeback, but they couldn't get it. Because when you buy a working spot and you don't show up, like, that means that nobody else could have bought that working spot. And it's like an airline ticket or a concert ticket or a movie ticket. It's like no refunds. But for a boarding train, if somebody's, we have dogs that don't make it unfortunately, for the 2 months, meaning they were put down because they were so dangerous, they couldn't keep them alive for two more months. We'll give somebody all their money back. But after a boarding train, nobody's asking us for their money back. Not a partial refund, not a full refund, not extra training, because we're doing a good job and we're picking the right people. We're not picking people. We don't say, hey, if you're not happy, are you going to give us a charge back? But just the way we run our business. So that's not to say it can't happen, but after 15 years, I've never seen it happen in my company. So I have nothing in place. I have nothing in place. Next.
Crystal, how to teach my dog to get a people's feel?
One more. To people's feel?
To get a people's feel.
I have no idea. Beyond my skill set. Next.
Bill. Already read that. Michelle. Going over your old videos and you have the most consistent hairstyle ever.
That's because so I don't true. Do fucking shit with
fucking
it.
Fucking changed it in like 15 years.
I haven't done anything. This is
probably longer than that. How long you had that long ass hair
for? No, I've cut it too.
Since like the 80s?
I've cut it dramatically. It used to be really long.
What was the picture you posted on Facebook? Was it a memory?
It was
you
a memory.
You had like short hair in that one.
That was when
I was.
That was
your first wedding. Your first wedding.
I had longer hair my first wedding.
Did you?
Yeah. This goes back. There's a picture of
it
me.
It didn't look like you had a ponytail though. Mm. It might have been like slicked
it
back.
It was slicked back, yeah. Yeah. Back then it was ponytail but slicked back. And it was not like this. It was like literally a ponytail. So it might have looked like that. There is a photo on my mother's refrigerator.
Like, did you ever have it come down like a normal, like,
bangs?
Not slicked back?
No, I've always had like a...
like Johnny Bravo.
Well, but I used to also have a forehead. I mean, I used to have hair down here.
Yeah, but I feel like...
Now I bang my head.
Most guys, like, their hair comes, like, this way, not back. Like, you have chosen to pull it back.
Yes, I have. Next.
Bangs are never a good idea. You just
That's not true.
Imagine if Jeff had bangs.
I like bangs on a woman.
Do you?
Yeah.
Not my thing. No. Michelle, going over your old videos and you have the most... just read that. Yeah. Cheyenne and Zeke. Zeke and I are a nice field... that I found near our home. There's a cat fight going on somewhere in the neighborhood. We can hear it. Zeke's doing great at ignoring it.
Awesome.
Christine, after work, my boyfriend and I take two dogs separate ways. When reunited at home, hackles raise, sometimes growling. Have gotten into fights, tried bonking, may not have had good timing. E-collar correction?
Well, if you're bonking, the chances are you're bonking as a reaction, then that's not what a bonker does. Your bonker is a proactive tool. So you go to the remote collar. Or you go do something more physical. Next.
Nicole, how to safely correct a 17-week-old puppy? He's a Doberman mix and gets around very fast during training. And when he can see my adult dog, my adult has some reactivity. I use a Herm Springer for her.
What's your dog? What do you want to correct your dog for? I need way more information. Next.
Kyle says, thanks, guys.
You're welcome, Kyle.
Sage. Brother's new puppy jumps and nips, but his partner is against bonking, all for an e-collar, though he doesn't know how to use one, let alone afford one.
Okay, so so he's not going to get an e-collar. He doesn't want bonking. And this is not even your dog. It's your brother's partner's dog. So let your brother's partner do all the research, figure it out, and solve the problem. Because you own a Doberman. And if you don't fucking get this shit straight, you have no idea what you shouldn't have gotten yourself a Doberman. Okay? Should have gotten yourself a fish. So you're going to have a wake-up call saying... hey, person, if you're going to get a Doberman, you better learn how to apply a proper punisher for dangerous behavior or get rid of the dog now. End of story. Next.
LG, Jeff, no, I've never had a dog in heat before.
Yeah. So dogs in heat can do a couple of things. They can fuck like crazy. They are open to attacks. They definitely can get more snarky, more aggressive. They can get more clingy to humans. They can be more nervous. There's a lot of different variables. A lot of different variables can happen. Yep.
St. Lee, hi guys. What to do when my dog and I approach a large blown up black cat on the front lawn for Halloween and the head moved on it and she got very scared and growled and barked. Fearful of it?
Have some fun and let her bite it. That's going to be a one damn flat cat. So... actually, no, it won't. Those are
the air. It just keeps going.
I know they actually have holes in them already.
Yeah.
If not, they would explode.
Right.
So what I would do is this. I would love, Halloween is a good time then, that blow up cat. Let's not call it fear. Let's call it something else. My dog barked at an inflatable cat. So let's get fear out of the equation, okay? Because when we do fear, we think avoidance, right? So instead go, okay, dog, you're going to learn to walk by this Halloween decoration and not give a shit. And keep walking by. Start at 15 feet, start at 20 feet, work your way in, work your way back out, work your way in. Do sit stays, do down stays. Get your dog to learn how to deal with big fat cat. Next.
Summer, we have our 8-month-old bell trained to go potty since he was 4 months old. No accidents in 2 months. But he's been hitting the bell even if he doesn't have to go potty. How to narrow his understanding of potty bell?
I don't know, because I would never teach a dog how to use a bell. Why? Because at 8 months old, I'd be calling into a fucking show asking how to get this bell problem solved. What?
You're so snarky.
It's true. I'm sorry. I think the bell is a stupid idea.
I know. They get smart. They're like, I just want to go outside.
That doesn't make you stupid, by the way. That doesn't make you stupid and doesn't mean you did anything wrong. Mm-mm. But that's why I don't train the bell. Like, I take my dogs out when I feel they have to go to the bathroom, which is when I fucking want to go outside. Mm-hmm. It's like, go to the bathroom right now. Or at 3 a.m. in the RV, if girl is whining, that means she has
to get her outside.
That means get her outside. Right. So that's like, that's an unusual, like, you don't whine at 3 a.m. Something's going on and you got to go to the bathroom. So what I do is this. I don't know how to do that because I don't teach dogs how to ring a bell. Now, that doesn't mean I can't stop them from ringing it, but I don't know how to do that training. Next.
Melinda, switch my 4-month-old Dobie pup off transitional leash to a prong per your advice. Game changing is an understatement. Thank you so much. Now if only I can get him to stop whining in public. Drama king.
So I'm not against any sort of leash, but if to me, a prong collar is going to give you the most gentlest, most powerful control over your dog. With a leash hand movement, I should say. Remote collar is going to be the most powerful, but there's more of a skill set to that. Next.
Be a good dog, University. Love your videos. Love your perspective and approach. We are kindred spirits. What are your thoughts on addressing the nervous system during addressing anxiety?
You're talking too smart for me. I don't talk smart, so we're not kindred spirits anymore, okay? You've outsmarted me. You've graduated from kindred U with a master's, and I'm still in kindred freshman biology. So the nervous system? Mm-hmm. Ask the question again, and I'm going to rephrase that.
What are your thoughts on addressing the nervous system during addressing anxiety?
Okay, so I'm going to just say, how do I deal with an anxious dog? Okay, I'm just going to leave it at that, because I don't know how to address nervous systems in dogs. So what? How do I deal with anxiety is this. Massive amounts of structure. Consequences for bad choices. Believe it or not, I would keep my rewards to a neutral tone with no excitement, because that can create arousal. Arousal can create more of something, and we have an anxiety issue, so possibly more anxiety. And I would push my dog past their comfort zone with guidance. So I have something, there's something called flooding with guidance. So flooding is, oh, you're afraid of dogs? There's a bunch of dogs. Throw them outside, close the door. 30 dogs are out there. That's called flooding. Not a good idea. I don't recommend it. Flooding with guidance. I've got the leash. I've got the dog. I've got a stockyard whip. I create a 3 to 4 to 5 foot barrier around the dog. And I walk through and I show the dog, look, you can walk through and all these dogs are going to move away. And then the dog goes, holy shit, none of these dogs are coming up to me. I feel safe. And the next thing you know, the dog goes, dogs don't freak me out. Next.
Robin, I want to try the pre-walk bonk, but my dog gets excited the minute I head in the direction of the door. Is that when I bonk him?
You should bonk him even before that excitement of the walking towards the door. So you want to bonk at the first sign of arousal. So you want to probably go even back. Next.
St. Lee, thanks for all you do. I'm always referring people to you.
Thank you.
Kyle, it's almost heartbreaking watching my happy puppy suddenly choose aggression as a way of correcting other dogs. It all happened when he had his ball. I'm thinking it could be ball aggression.
Well, the thing about it is a resource. But also, Kyle, man, don't beat yourself up, buddy. Don't you dare. This 10-month-old German Shepherd. Okay? 12 months, it's going to be even more challenging. 18 months, who the fuck knows what you're going to have at the end of that leash. So, this is the thing. You're thinking, did you do something wrong? Did you get the wrong dog? Did you do the wrong training? Did I fuck up somewhere? Could I have done better? Did I make a mistake? Oh my gosh, I created this mess. All this self-doubt. A lot of different other things. Be really, really careful about going down that path, buddy. Because, it's a 10-month-old dog. You got your hands full. You got your hands full. I would have my hands full. Joelle still has her hands full. So, we always know when Joelle's in the building. It's instant. So, be careful there. All right? Be careful. And I think a good example is Joelle. The tougher she is with her dog, the better the dog's behavior is. She's got the kind of dog where you give it any fucking attention and love, it makes it worse. Now, that doesn't mean engagement. Don't get that wrong. So give Wesley more engagement, things are better. More affection, things are worse.
Yeah.
Ignore him and correct him, things are just fine.
Yeah.
So it's but that's that dog and their relationship. So meanwhile, she owns another dog that was not her first dog that doesn't have those issues. And then the next dog she gets, who knows? So there is some responsibility on the dog. So it's so funny that every once in a while someone says, oh, so you're blaming the dog? It's I think that's maybe the fourth time, fifth time, maybe sixth time I've actually said that. Mm-hmm. It's no, most of it is our fault.
Mm-hmm.
But you can't discount genetics too.
Yeah.
Most service dogs that are bred for service dog work are washed out.
Mm-hmm.
Up to 90% of single-purpose nose dogs that are bred specifically for the TSA nose work program are washed out.
Yep.
In some breeders. But to get the contract, they want a 50% guarantee over 3 to 5 years, over a three-year average. But a buddy of mine had a litter, they only accepted 10% of them. And it's not because they don't want to spend the money. They've got a huge budget.
Yeah. Genetics.
They literally are looking for, oh, geez. One buying organization was looking for 4,000 dogs. They came back with 400. They
wow.
can't find enough single-purpose nosework dogs. That's why a lot of them are seeing non-traditional dogs doing, spaniels, beagles, which are, I don't want to say non-traditional, but what you don't think of, They're odor dogs. And a lot of dogs with high drive can do odor work. Next.
The Noble Dogs, $4.99. How do you know when you need to upgrade the remote from the mini educator to the boss? What are the telltale signs?
I think, Grant, I think if you find yourself, fit is important. So as long as you have proper fit, proper contact, and you find yourself in the 60s and 70s often, and your dog blows through 100, which dogs do. Guys, dogs go through underground fencing on purpose multiple times, which is way more powerful than a shock collar. What happens is you probably want to go to the boss. Next.
Melinda, I was dealing with lunging and extreme pulling to the point of getting shooting pains up my spine before switching to the prong. You saved my back, LOL.
Wow. Somebody, Melissa, do me a favor, screenshot that and send it to me so I can put that into a meme. truth about prong collars, please? Mm-hmm. Thank you. That was the right length of statement.
Yes.
Thank you.
Nicole, also, what's your best advice for new dog trainers to learn more and build their business? I've got an ABC degree. The more I learn, the more I see that method doesn't always work. Find a mentor?
So that method actually rarely will work at people's homes where you're being hired to stop unwanted behaviors because they're anti-punishment. They might not say it publicly, but it's quite obvious by their program and their mentorship program, where a mentor will literally say, if you use these tools, or if I find out that you're using these tools, I will fail you. Ooh, so much for being a fucking good mentor there, asshole. So, I mean, I've heard horror stories from the mentorship program of that organization. It's like, pre-screen your mentors, guys. So what I would suggest is this: work with a ton of dogs, go to as many seminars as you can, ideally do an internship, work for free. So I was talking with Cass today, who was not crying.
Nice.
Okay. Nice. First day ever. Okay.
I still cry every day.
So I'm just really good at going deep.
Yeah, we know.
Yeah, I mean, sorry, but with an intern, that's my job. My job is to turn her into an unstoppable dog training business owner. So I'm doing the business part of it, and with that comes personal growth. And with that comes overcoming fear. So that's the internship program. That's my contribution to it. Because that's the number one thing stopping young dog trainers is fear. And it's fear of everything. Fear of failure. But there's things that are even bigger than fear of failure. Fear of your colleagues and their comments, which, by the way, don't matter. So I would do an internship, but work for free. So she's smart because she already has a very successful business in Canada, but she's literally working here for free for 3 months. So she's giving up a large amount of her income, but she's smart because she'll recoup that in the next year of business, and then some more, and then be on a new trajectory. So her growth, her 5-year growth, will happen in 3 years. So that's worth her 3 months of time. And I don't know if she realized that by doing this, but you don't give up 3 months' pay to just like learn how to train a dog. So what I would suggest is pretty soon the business model is people are going to be paying business owners to intern at their place of business. Because unless you want to become a lawyer, a doctor, or just in a specialized field, why are you paying a university instead of paying the actual business? So there are businesses that I can imagine paying them $10,000 to $20,000 a year to work there instead of going to a college. Unless you want to party and have a good time and hook up. Then go to college. Next.
Kathleen, hey guys, Max stayed in place for 2 hours while I put together a TV wall mount. Mount was a pain in the ass, but the dog wasn't.
Now, could you imagine how stressful that fucking wall mount would have been if you had to keep correcting your dog?
Mounting a TV is no joke.
It's no joke at all.
It's a team effort.
I know. So kudos to you and great real world training there. Next.
Pauline, your tips have helped me so much. Thank you. I'd like to play tuck it with my two dogs. One gets possessive over the ball. Is it possible to train him to play nice?
Well, I don't know about playing nice, but to stop possession, yes. That would be through an application of a punisher, which would be no. So the dog gets possessive of the ball. No. Boom. Next.
Keaton.
That was universal sign for remote collar stim, by the way.
Thoughts on rough tough and or gunner kennels?
We have a rough tough kennel here.
I like it.
I like it. We've never used a gunner kennel, but I've heard good things about them. Next. But I have no personal experience at all, and neither of those are my sponsors, because we have no fucking sponsors. Nobody gives us money. But speaking of that, is there a What Would Jeff Do cup anywhere?
Yeah.
Can you grab it for me?
An espresso machine.
Do you know how to make coffee yet? Do you know how to make coffee yet?
No, the intern doesn't even know how to make coffee. What?
We need to teach her tomorrow.
Yes, I'll teach her how to make espresso.
So we're starting a mug club. Steven Crowder, don't sue me, please. We're starting a mug club. It's going to come with a coffee mug, a big What Would Jeff Do sticker, and a small What Would Jeff Do sticker. Shipped to you for, I'm trying to come in under $20. I'm trying to come in under $20. Shipping included. I'm trying to, but let me see if I can. We're still pricing out shipping, and we're sourcing the boxes to put them in, because I don't want a bunch of breakage. But I just ordered my first 144 of them to test to see how we do. Next.
Interesting number. $4.99 Pop Tat.
That's a common number.
144.
12 dozen? That's just how it is.
It comes in dozens.
Well, I mean, historically, you can buy...
I would have done like 150. Like, what the
fuck you is could have 144? Done six less. I mean, Angela could have answered
or
that
140.
One.
140. Why 144?
Because it's 12 times 12. That's just the number. So when you're in the wholesale business, you know dozens more. So you don't come from wholesale.
No, I don't.
Right. Thanks.
The Noble Dogs, $4.99. How long will you typically keep a short hair comfort pad on your dog without rotating, or a long haired comfort pad without rotation and wingtip?
Okay, two different questions.
Whoa.
Short hair. Usually you don't have to rotate those that much. There are dogs though that are, because historically you're doing that on a longer fur dog, and the only thing that you those little barbs there do push in. So do we rotate those as much? That's a good question to ask you.
We rotate them all no matter what the dog is wearing. Okay. We have a schedule. They're all getting rotated like four times a day.
There you go. There you go. Next.
$4.99 Top Chat from Dino. Not a dog trainer, but I've tried Torin, a board and train in my home with your videos. I've tried to run. I thought it was one word. He put his one word. I'm like,
you've gone on tour. Dino's gone on tour. Dino's gone on tour to all the nightclubs doing Frank Sinatra songs.
You guys, grammar, please. I just read. Like, I need punctuation and spaces. Hush. I'm going to give you the hand.
Speaking of dogs in heat, next.
Not a dog trainer, but I've tried to run a board and train in my home with your videos.
Excellent idea.
Do you feel like most dogs can be rehabbed given the right structure?
I actually do. I actually think that 90% of the dogs out there would do better just watching our free videos than paying a dog trainer. Unless you're dealing with massive separation anxiety, and you can still do it, but it's harder, and dog aggression. Next.
Pauline, your tips have helped me so much. Thank you. I'd like to play Tuck It. Oh, I already read that.
Yep.
I'm lost, guys. I'm sorry.
Well, no, because whenever you do a top chat, it bumps me.
Yep. Chris, struggling getting new clients. Any advice? Appreciate you guys.
Yeah, number one, take 100% responsibility. First of all, do you suck? It's good to come up with that. It's like, are you getting results at all? Can you actually train a dog? Number one. That is probably, I would say, 40% or less of the equation. It might even be 30%. Which means 60 to 70% is your human skills. How are your human skills? Are you trying to sound smart? A lot of people like to insult me because I don't sound smart. I don't sound smart for a reason. Number one, I'm not very smart. But number two, I'm speaking to dog owners and I'm not trying to impress them with jargon. I want them to win. My ego gets stroked by your success stories, not by how smart I am. So we all have an ego. All of our egos need to be fed. It's called life. My ego is fed through you being successful. Therefore, I will use words, techniques, demos in order for you to win. I will explain it in a way that you could win. Because then you win and my ego gets stroked. Not by me showing off my skills. By the way, that's probably the best piece of business advice that you will hear all year. Right there. Right there. All right, guys? So, you're not impressing me with your high drive males. All right? So, what I would do is also work tons of dogs and document the hell out of them. I want to be able to go to your website at 2 o'clock in the morning. I want to be able to go to all your social media pages, and I want to be able to see what you're doing and see what you're up to. I also want to know, I want to be able to read comments, read your engagement, and I also want to know, I'm going to go to your personal page. And on your business page, if you project one thing and you're beer bonging it on your personal page, I'm not going to hire you. Okay? So, number one, go through your personal page and clean it up. No politics. Sports, you got to even be careful with that. Sexual orientation, people shouldn't have a problem, but they do. But that, you can leave alone. Big thing is politics. Keep it off your page. Getting into arguments, disagreements, anything like that, get it off. I don't want to go to your page and see every dog that's going to die this Friday. Don't want to see it. I want to see postings of all the lost dogs in the neighborhood. I want to go to your page to learn. So, number one, can I go to your social media and learn? Here's a really good thing. Here's the advice that I gave my brother. My brother is a business consultant that's having a slow year. He just sold his house. The advice I gave him was, Mike, and he has to put it, he's got to buy another house for tax reasons. I said, Mike, take $100,000 of it, stick it in the bank. What I want you to do over the next year is I want you to do so much free social media that I can hire you, that I don't have to hire you, and I can learn everything I can from your free content without hiring you. That's the goal. And the $100,000 is assuming nobody does hire you. But I assure you, people will. So can I go to your website and learn? Are you holding stuff back? Next.
Woo!
I mean, this is what, I mean, you can join my mentorship program, which is pretty much doing Skypes with me. Next.
Good stuff. Chris, just read that. Sorry. Michelle. Hi, Cass from Calgary. Got all the Canadians watching you.
We're trying to get up there, by the way.
Summer.
Who's that? Who said that? Chris?
No, that's Michelle Anderson.
Oh, Michelle. Michelle! Fan. Give me a fucking location in Calgary.
Number one YouTube fan.
That's right.
Summer. Oh, $4.99 top chat from the Noble Dogs. What advice do you have on running a free group dog training class as well as giving a 40-minute presentation speech on dog training?
Do what you love to do, buddy. So pick what you love to do. So free group class, you can do that. Just I would focus on one or two things. And as far as giving a speech, what do you like to talk about? Because passion is everything. Next.
Summer, 8-month-old, has been barking at noises outside. I've been holding back a hard bonk since he's 6 pounds, but finally did a harder one. Now he comes right to me for guidance when there's a noise. Bonking works.
Yeah, it does, or else I wouldn't tell people to do it if it didn't work. Kudos to you. Next. 6-pound dogs don't get free passes. A 6-pound dog's bark is just as annoying as a 60-pound dog's bark.
Sure.
In fact, it's probably more annoying.
Cheyenne and Zeke, there's a squirrel 30 feet away from us, and Zeke is trembling in his double down. Would you allow that to happen?
Or have him chase a squirrel? Next.
LG, I was just trying to keep up with her training and exercise. I haven't walked her for the last week, and she's getting cabin fever. So no more walks for a few weeks. Sorry for the dumb question.
What dumb question?
I don't know. We don't have any dumb questions on the show.
LG, she has to even ask a question?
Yeah, but I don't remember anything dumb. So, I don't know.
So, there's no dumb questions. If you're brand new and I'm snarky, it wasn't a dumb question. I'm snarky. On this show, I'm snarky. You don't ask dumb questions. We don't allow it, nor do I imply it. Next.
Mario, hi guys. I was listening to the rerun of the last podcast, and apparently there's another Mario out there. Maybe I should change mine to my future dog training company. You're not the only Mario.
Is you talking about Dino?
No, this is Mario.
Because there's Dino Mario.
This is just Mario.
Oh.
Mario Alvarado.
Yeah, there's a lot of Marios. Mario, if you didn't know, Mario is a common name. News alert.
I've never met another Joel. I know they're out there.
And they don't have fucking they don't have coffee mugs or keychains or shot glasses with your name on it.
None.
I know. You just lose.
I check everywhere though.
Well, you know what you
every like novelty store we go to, I'm like,
okay. So
nope, it's not there.
So can I make a suggestion?
What?
Okay.
Make my own.
A wide tip Sharpie marker and buy a bunch of Joel shit. Okay.
It looks so like it's all like crooked.
L E.
Like, why is it not a thing?
Or what you do is you buy a bunch of Lee stick-ons or Leah stick-ons and you cut them in half. Never. And you...
Part of the thrill is just, like, checking.
I know.
Maybe one day it'll be there.
Maybe one day
and I will buy it.
Right.
Robin, yes, I'll send you the evidence of our happy walk. You can't take the video with the leash in the left hand and remote control in the right. We'll have a friend record us. Used to be impossible to walk. Great.
Awesome. Congratulations. Next.
Julia's gallery. You need to meet Petey. I am on it. P.S. Thank you.
You're welcome. Next.
Tarpy. My dog can spend all day with our other dogs, but with play, balls, etc., she attacks our smaller dog. She's also aggressive with other dogs she doesn't know. Any tips? Prong collar training good so far.
Okay, so this is not going to be a prong collar training. It's going to be a remote collar training. You're going to have to apply a punisher at the right moment. I'm not going to tell you how to do it. It's not because I'm trying to hold anything back. There's way too many variables for shit to go down wrong. So you'll end up with a dead dog or an injured dog, and I don't want you to do it. Now, we would have to do a Skype. That doesn't mean you have to pay to play with me. Skypes do cost money, but that's not why I'm doing this. But I'm sure you can understand how unethical it would be for me to give you advice on how to stop your dog from being aggressive to unknown dogs. Other than right now, keep your dog away from unknown dogs. Your dog doesn't need, it sounds like you got your own pack. Your dog doesn't need to be with unknown dogs right now. As far as your dogs, what you're going to have to do is just be smart and be safe. That's the best advice I can give you right now. Next.
Oh, LG asked a question about the female being in heat.
Oh, that was massively snarky.
That was snarky.
That was extremely snarky. That, in fact, was so fucking snarky, we're going to make a clip out of it. That was not a dumb question at all. At all. So it's your first time on the show. So you're used
to it. It's her first dog in heat.
So you're just getting used to me. You're just getting used to me. Next.
Zombie, it's frustrating to learn that misinformation made me rehome a dog 3 years ago after months of purely positive, force-free methods. Who your techniques could have trained because I truly believe that I wasn't good enough.
Yep.
Your content is now not only saving my life with my current dogs, but also the dogs of friends who are struggling and feeling hopeless, just like I did 3 years back. Love you guys.
So, who's that?
Zombie.
Okay, so Zombie. Number one, you're 100% absolutely correct. Number two, you did the best you could with the information that you had. Okay? So, could you, would you, should you? You know what? I wish I could reparent my oldest kids all over again with the information that I had now. I wish I had the money management skills now from when I owned a $3.5 million company. I wish I had the communications I have now with my current staff that I've had with past staff. I wish that I knew a lot of things now at 53 that I knew that I did not know even when I was 52, let alone 22, right? So, you know, we gotta be really careful about that. But the reason why I yell, I scream, I come across as blunt, dickish, and asshole, in your face, intense, is because literally somebody fucked you up for those 4 months. That is why. And it didn't have to happen. But that's not on you. But that's my passion right there. Okay? Next. Next.
Welcome. Wait. Like, shit's getting deep tonight.
Is it?
Yeah, get your popcorn out.
What? What are you talking about?
You're giving some good advice tonight. I like it.
Okay. Thanks, Joelle. Wow. First time. Got a compliment from Joelle.
Note it.
Hold on.
Wait.
What time? What is today?
Don't get used to it.
I'm not, trust me, I'm not going to. October 16th, 2020. Day in history.
LG, my male dog is going for his grand championship and whining because of the female. They're separated, of course. At one point, everyone was whining, and I was like, I'm moving without the dogs. I understand. I have empathy.
Hey, man, or you have a hell of a fucking litter. Next.
Yeah. Ecky Madness. Hi, J&J. When it comes to correcting for pressure against other dogs, cats, would I correct on high with the e-collar the moment his body language changes, or correct high when he growls and lunges?
Body language change. Next.
It's only Hazard. I have a year-old blue heeler. She jumps over the fence. How do I fix this?
Jesus Christ. Damn. So, that's dangerous because you're going to end up with a dead dog. You know that. So, number one, this is what you're going to do. Put the dog on a long line. Ready? Dog on a long line, dog on a prong collar. What I want you to do is stand far enough away from the fence that when that dog races to the fence and jumps up, it can't, with you holding onto it, it can't clear the fence. Okay? So by the time it gets to the end of that long line, it gets corrected on the prong collar. Okay? Then I also want you to have a remote collar too. We're doing a double whammy. You got it? This dog is going to go flying backwards on the prong, and it's going to be corrected hard on the shock collar. Yep. That's how we're going to do it. We're going to make it suck. You trying to jump over that fence sucks. So a lot of folks will be like, geez, Jeff, that sounds so harsh. Well, okay. So then pick your dead dog off the road. Your choice. Or pick your dog that's not dead off the road, that's dying in your arms. Or keep your half-dead dog off the road, take it to the emergency room, and then go three mortgage payments or your life. Three mortgage payments or your life. Fuck. What do I do? Or my suggestion, make it suck to go over the fence. Next.
Mm-hmm. John. Hey, Jeff, my dog isn't reactive in public. He doesn't care for people when people come over. He shuts down and barks at new people coming over and shakes in fear. What am I doing wrong?
Well, I don't know if you're doing anything wrong. So he doesn't bark at people in public. So when you're at the house, people come over, he gets really nervous. Mm-hmm. So he barks. Stop the barking. Tell the dog to go to place, lie down, and be quiet and mind his business. Next.
Anthony, hey guys, just listening in as I work. Keep up the great work.
Thank you so much.
Maddie, my dog has started whining and downstays. This is a habit she had when I first got her, but broke it naturally months ago. Tips on training it out for good?
Yeah, remote collar. So your dog is anxious. Your dog is struggling with some anxiety right now for some reason. We don't know what it is. We might never know. So remote collar is going to be able to break that cycle. Next.
Cheyenne and Zeke. Oh no, Zeke's getting gray, more white fur showing up throughout his body. He's six, but sure as hell doesn't act old.
Yeah, don't go by physical.
He's getting grays.
Don't
too.
Go by physical appearance. Don't.
I got grays.
Yeah, I got grays right here.
Yep, the salt and pepper. No, you got something going on back.
Oh yeah, oh yeah, no, my whole head. Mm-hmm. Yep, I know. I'm aware.
Julia's gallery.
Thank you for reminding me.
I have a great hairstylist if you need to go to work. She'll fix you up. Julia's gallery. Oh, quickie. I take care of my dad on the weekends. His neighbor had an underground fence put in for two dobies. I'm afraid to walk Petey, the staffy, because of one zap and he's prey.
Huh?
That's what it says. I don't know what that means.
I don't know what that means either. Also, with your fence jumper, you can actually run underground fence on the inside of your fence 4 feet off your hard fence. You can do that too as well. Next.
CB and LH videos. So I have two male pits, 4 and 5 years old, 3 male Roddy brothers, 6 months old, 1.5 year female blue heeler. All is good, but any suggestions for the coming months? Thanks.
What's happening? I don't know.
All is good.
All is good. Massive amounts of structure. Keep it up.
Yeah, 3 male Roddy brothers, 6 months old.
Oh, are you serious? You have 3 dogs from the same litter, all male.
2 male pits. 5 years old, 3 Roddy brothers, 6 months old, and a 1.5-year-old female blue heeler.
Okay, so reality check. Do you really want to hold on to all 3 of those Roddies? Reality check. That's a lot of dog. So, your household should be run like a boarding train. Massive amounts of structure. Double down on your training. Be demanding. Got it? Everybody's kenneled up at night. Everybody eats in their kennel. Everybody gets basic obedience commands. I mean, you're running a boarding train facility at your house, technically. Next.
Crystal, my dog is afraid of people. How to teach your dog to like people?
I can't make your dog like people, but I can get your dog to exist around people. How about if your dog doesn't like people? Do you like everybody? She's like, geez, Jeff, actually, for starters, I don't like you.
Mm-hmm.
So I think what you're going to do, our goal is this. If you came to us, our goal would be this. I'm going to get your dog to be around people and not give a shit. Because that might be what you really want. Or do you want a dog to go up to every single person and be friendly? I don't know if your dog's capable of it. And do you really want that? You know? So some people are like, in their boarding training application, they'll be like, level of expectation. I want my dog to be friendly with strangers. I'm like, I don't know if that's going to happen or not. Like, I don't want strangers coming up and petting my dog. I don't know what they're going to do. And I don't think we should allow just anybody to come up to our dogs. So getting your dog to be around people, existence is number one. So that's what we would work for, is existence. So how do you do that? Teach your dog a proper heel. Get your dog around a lot of people. Don't let your dog go towards them. Don't let people come towards your dog. Keep your dog in command and start just existing in a world of chaos. Next.
Okay, Tice, my dogs have ruined the door trim jumping to let me know they need to go out.
Mm-hmm.
What should I do to train to save money on replacing woodwork? Thanks. Even if I hang bells, they'll scratch the wood door.
Yeah, I know. Correct them for doing it. So you can use a bonker. Number one, they jump up on the doors. No, whiz 2, 3, 4 bonkers at them. Boom, 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 boom. You know those sparklet bottles, those 5-gallon jugs that they use for the water, take an empty one of those. Throw that out the door while they're jumping up. Remote collar stem. Bottom line is, if you want to make jumping, you have to make it suck. Mm-hmm. If you want to stop jumping, I mean, you have to make it suck. It seems harsh, but it's like, no, it's not. Stops behavior. Next.
H. Grace, thank you for all the free content. My dog, Reactive Dog, has come so far with your advice. I'm psyched to be catching this live for the first time ever. Hope you guys are having a good night.
Yeah, things are really good. Thank you. Thanks for being here. Really, really enjoy it. And we're on every Monday, Wednesday, and we get every show. There's like always people that are like, I'm catching you finally. I've been listening to replays for 3 years. I finally catch one live. Isn't that weird? It's like, did your schedule just all of a sudden change?
Yeah, busy schedule.
Yeah, this is really great. This is great. And if you missed the live podcast, don't forget, we're on SoundCloud. So we're on YouTube. So this show is live on YouTube. It disappears in 24 hours because then Melissa does some post-editing, and she doesn't take anything out. She just she actually adds content to it. She adds the intro to it, the intro song, the outro song. She adds some links to it and then reposts it up in about 48 hours. So then show number 606 will probably be up on Friday, mm-hmm. for instance. Well, today's Wednesday. And then we're also on Spotify, SoundCloud, iHeartRadio, the Google platform of voices, and I think some, a couple of different Apple products as well. Next.
Melinda, only time pup fights the prong is when trying to avoid walking past dogs within 15 feet on leash. What is the best way to desensitize him to other dogs if I don't know people with balanced dogs?
That's the hard part. Do existence. So you got to advocate for your dog. So what you're going to do is have your dog around other dogs. By around, that doesn't mean like interacting. Here's a great example. Today, I did a one-on-one, the same one-on-one where I was making out my hands and knees. So I put that dog into a down, and then I had Ben come out with, what was that dog that you wanted to work with?
Maggie.
Isn't that his dog? No, no.
Daycare Maggie.
I had Maggie, him bring out a daycare dog named Maggie, and I put Maggie in a downstay. So he put Maggie in a downstay. The client put his dog in a downstay. They were about a meter away from each other. That's socialization. Mm-hmm. They don't necessarily have to interact. They're in the same room, existing with each other. They both were aware of it. They both were aware of it. And they just chilled out. That's socialization. That will help. Next.
Grace, dog's nervous in the car, gets in and out fine, downs but can't settle. Quiet, but doesn't take food if offered. Should I just not worry? We travel and ride a lot. Thanks.
Yes, forget the food. Fuck the food. Guys, we're food trainers. We use food. Like, if you look at every photo, every one of my staff, excuse me, has a treat pouch on, which is the dog's daily food. They all have clickers on them. So as much as I'm talking about punishment here, we actually clicker train every dog on the property. They're all clicker trained. But we're talking about stopping unwanted behaviors. But when a dog is nervous and fearful, it won't take food. Our dogs won't. Your dogs won't. Your neighbor's dog won't. When a dog is nervous and fearful, it doesn't eat. So food doesn't work. Food fails. Food fails in positive reinforcement training. Food fails. Food doesn't exist in correcting an unwanted behavior historically, unless you're counter conditioning. But food is not the answer. What's the answer is going to be compulsion, which means force. So in the car, down. We're driving. If you get up a little bit, no. Down. Boom. That's how you do it. That's how we do it. And it works. Next.
Kyle, thanks, guys. It's like I was expecting this to happen in a way, but the amount of time and work I put into training just feels like a bit of a setback.
Kyle, do me a favor, buddy. Take a break. Mm-hmm. Take a break. Don't take 3 months off. Take a break. Do me a favor. Today's Wednesday. This weekend, the show, we're not sure if we're doing it Friday night or Saturday night because we're on the road in the RV. We don't know when we're going to have Wi-Fi. Monday's show. Between now and Monday, all you're doing is playing with your dog. Got it? Kennel them up. Take a break from obedience. Just have some fun. Next.
More good advice. You're on fire. LG. My dog is 14 months. This is her first heat. Catahoula
plot. Really? It's 14 months?
I know she's still changing behaviorally. Any advice on working through the changes and periodic backslides? At times, it's discouraging.
Dog's in heat. No rhyme or reason, man.
It's discouraging every month.
Yep. You can't rationalize with a chick that's menstruating.
You really can't. Like, there's none. Zero.
Clear out of the house. I got 6 daughters. I'm out of here. Mm-hmm. All right? So.
Let her just, like, do her thing.
Let her do her thing. Just.
Keep her safe.
That's right.
Don't let male dogs approach her.
Hide all the kitchen knives.
Yeah.
So, hide all the kitchen knives and be careful what you say. Next. Mm-hmm.
Age run. Brother, sister, 2-year-old Karen's rescued 3 months ago. Suddenly, the female won't let the male eat. Snarls, growls, barks at her brother. He can easily kick her ass, but he submits. Suggestions?
Yeah, you should be feeding them in separate crates. Next.
Patty, my dog is dominant and reactive to everything. Aussie and barks constantly. 10 months old.
So barking is easy, guys. Barking is easy to stop. Number one, throw a bark collar on your dog. It stops. Number two, fuck the bark collar. No, bonk the dog. It stops. Fuck the bonker. Number three, get yourself a shock collar. Proper shock collar. No, hit the stop barking button. 3 options for you right there. All punitive. All barking is stopped through the proper application of a punisher. Don't teach quiet, click, and reward. That's how you're going to teach more barking. Next.
Julia's Gallery. Awesome on the mug club. I'm in.
Cool.
Kara.
We'll announce it. It'll be on the website and the show.
My dog won't heal properly on walks when one of the other dogs in the house is being walked by someone else or myself. She whines and is frantic. I've tried e-collar correction, ignores the prong.
So that's going to be a skill set. It's going to be a timing issue. And
hold on, there's more.
Oh.
I've tried low levels and high levels, hard and gentle leash pops. E-collar heel is just her going right back to trying to get back in front of me. I've tried basically teaching heel square 180s as well.
Okay. Are your 180s look like my 180s in the video? Are they as firm as my 180s? And are you doing spatial pressure exercises, which we haven't made a video on yet, but we will?
We do need to do that. We really need to do that.
I know. Okay. I know. Add it to the list. Next.
Dino donated $1.99 with my personal dog, not business. Haha.
Thanks. Yeah, we don't get alerts on the $1.99s.
Yeah.
It's you know what? YouTube, we appreciate the $1.99s as much as the $4.99s. Can you give us an alert on those too? So anything lower than $4.99, we don't get an alert on. It shows up on Joelle's screen highlighted, but it shows up in the feed. When somebody does a $4.99 and up top chat, she gets a little bubble, like this little bubble at the top.
That actually bumps it to the top.
That bumps it to the top. But YouTube, we appreciate $1.99 just as much as $4.99.
Yeah.
Come on. Cut the shit, YouTube.
Cut the shit.
Next. You're going to deplatform me anyway, so cut the shit.
Francis, greetings, J&J. Just had Rose spayed, vet advised. Keep her calm, on leash, 2 to 3 days. Rose started whining in place today. I thought, what would Jeff do? We practiced commands, helped. We both miss our walk.
Yeah, that's the thing with spay and neuter. You got to keep, or surgery. You got to keep them calm. That's why we spend so much time on duration. I just started running Girl. So Girl is one of my high drive shepherds, 0 to 100. She knows two speeds, lie down and do nothing or go 100 miles per hour.
Literally, she's crazy.
So she had her second cruciate surgery, different legs. That's usually how it works. Same with ACLs. It's been almost 6 months.
Already?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
I feel like it just happened.
No. So maybe it's been 5. I just started running her. And even then, I'm still not running her full bore.
Yeah.
I'm still not running her like I normally run her. I'm waiting to, like, I'm taking her rehab really slow. Really slow. But I wouldn't let her outside even to go to the bathroom unless she was on a leash. Because she tried to, like, play. She didn't give a shit.
She was trying to jump her freaking gate.
Yeah, she had two days of, like, this sucks.
I think it's because she was on pain meds.
And then after that, it was like, I'm ready to rip up the world. And meanwhile, it's like, there you go, surgery. Next.
Sasha, I was told by a neighbor I can't walk on a public sidewalk. My dog ignores, then it is rude for a neighbor telling me not to walk on a public sidewalk with my dog. Their dogs lunge at me.
I love people that
that
don't take responsibility for their own actions. Their neighbors, he's walking on the sidewalk in front of his neighbor's house.
Oh, and they're saying you can't walk.
The neighbor's dogs on the neighbor's property is lunging at his dogs. So because the neighbor can't control his dogs, it's this questioner's fault.
Of course.
It's called victim mentality. Mm-hmm. So your neighbor has victim mentality, refuses to take 100% responsibility, and also is entitled. Next.
Kara, I've tried low levels and high levels. Oh, I already read that. Britt. My dog was struggling, and a guy was like, someone don't look happy. I had to tell him to leave 3 times. I got pissed off because if I had not said anything, that wouldn't have happened. Judgment on the happy side yesterday. My German Shepherd walked past 5 charging dogs in the back, and each time it was a different house. I felt badass bragging.
Nice.
Kara, I had my first client the other day. The dog was very aggressive toward me, so I coached him for a distance. How to use the prong. He's happy. His back won't hurt anymore when walking his dog. Thanks, guys.
Good. Do me a favor, Kara, not to burst your bubble. If this is your first client and it was an aggressive dog, please be super careful working with aggression. Please be super careful. First of all, obviously, you're smart. You did it from a distance. But even then, there's a level of safety. So when I first got into dog training, I got bit a lot because I worked with dogs above my pay grade. I had owners whose dogs were on leashes. The dog lunged. The dog got away from the owner, and they bit me. So also, I did stupid stuff. You know what I mean? I put too much pressure on dogs. I didn't understand pressure on dogs. Now I put a lot of pressure on dogs, but I can read dogs better. So now we work with more dangerous dogs. I mean, in my seminars, I mean, think about this in my seminars, the dogs we have at the seminars.
Yeah.
And I'm not getting bit at all. Mm-hmm. Next.
LG, Jeff, you're smart enough to know to be nice and help others. That's plenty smart in my book. Now some advice for you. Don't ever discount your intelligence. Smart comes in many shades. You're smart.
I know.
You are smart. Thank you. You know a lot of stuff. He'll tell you the history of Providence, like, Here we go. No one else.
Here we go again.
He knows where the flood, where there was a flood. He'll be like, this square of brick is where it flooded in 1776. 1638.
So you know, you know that you tell the same fucking story every single time.
It's so true though.
But it gets, it's not true.
It is. You just corrected me. 1638, Providence.
And I might be wrong there. I just made that number up.
You know a lot of stuff, though. You don't give yourself enough credit.
Next.
Jeff is smart. Next. Austin, don't ask him about grammar, though. My 70-pound Amstaff mix rescue 1.5-year-old vomits every time he has a new or exciting event. He has 1 or 2 days delay, but happens every time. Any tips?
He vomits every time he has an exciting event?
Yeah.
That's a crappy fucking life. Mm. I would go to that. I'd go to the vet for that one. Next.
Laura, as I said before, I have 3 female GSD. 2 fought, Daisy and Onyx. I separated them. Annie and Onyx never fought. They need to get back together for my sanity.
Yeah, it's hard. It's hard. There's a skill set getting fighting dogs back together again. I don't feel comfortable explaining it to people online. I mean, I'm not trying to withhold any information. I just need to talk. I literally need to Skype with you because I need to see you. I need to read you. I need to know how you're responding to my advice. I need to know if you're going to follow through feel. I read people very well. I read people well just through written word, but through video, I read them extremely well. In person, I read them extremely well. Next.
Laura.
Obviously, my first 12 wives, I didn't. Next.
Austin, greetings from Westerly.
Hey, Westerly, what's up?
Kara, how do you come up with a company name?
Think of it. Kara's dog training. You write down a bunch of stuff. And then what you do is you see what's available as far as websites. So don't come up with a company name and then look on a website. If someone else has it, change your name. Trust me. Next.
Doc, hey guys, Ethan from Pensacola, Florida, bought the prong collar 2 days ago. It has completely changed my dog. No more pulling from my 2-year-old GSD. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Look at that.
Becky Lou, hi Jeff and Joelle.
Hey, Becky Lou.
Kara, forgot to mention about my whiny dog. I walk her with other dogs. I walk daily. She's calm and heals well. You need a confetti popper for when Joelle compliments you.
I need I believe that's the singular version. Of confetti popper.
Just one.
But just one. One per year. Mm-hmm. That's it. So I don't got to buy a gross of them.
I've complimented you a lot tonight. A lot, actually. Like, a lot. But only one confetti popper is warranted.
So maybe I should wait to
the end. No more!
So maybe I should wait to the end of the night. Just so you don't run out of confetti poppers?
Exactly.
Next.
Kara, tips for e-collar healing. What if a dog resists leash guidance?
One more time.
If the dog resists, so if she's trying to guide the dog back, it's going forward because of opposition reflex.
Right.
You do spatial pressure.
You do spatial pressure. Are you using a prong collar? Are you using a prong collar? So are you doing leash pressure back, remote collar down? Leash pressure back, remote collar down. Leash pressure back, remote collar down. Since the remote collar is not directional. Or are you doing remote collar and then using spatial pressure? Remote collar and then doing spatial pressure and using leash guidance at the same time?
There's so many. Like, we got to make a video.
We're also going to do a reactive dog class, you and I. Next.
Time.
It's 9:31. One more question.
Okay. Maddie, there are a lot of questions tonight, so I don't know if you'll get to this follow-up, but for correcting whining and...
Yours is the last question.
The last one! Look at that! For correcting whining and downstage, should I be using working level or higher?
Okay, yes. What I mean by that is when someone asks me to correct whining, do I use the momentary button, the continuous button, high level or no or low level? My response is yes. And I'm not trying to be snarky. What I mean is you don't know. Experiment. Like, figure it out on the dial. I don't know what the recipe is going to be. Okay. Anyway, guys, we're going to end the show. It's 9:30. We'll be doing a show possibly Friday night. I don't know. You don't know what? Because we're not leaving until I'm going to the gym Friday morning.
Me too.
So we're not going to leave.
Damn right.
I got to empty out the sewage tanks on the RV. So I got to wait till at least 8:30. So we're not going to be on the road till 9:30 or 10.
Okay.
Okay. So
good, because I got shit to do.
So what I'll do is we'll, We're either doing a show Friday night or Saturday night. And I'm not even sure what time we're doing the show, but you'll know by your YouTube alerts. Join our channel. So, guys, if you like the show, give us a thumbs up. And nobody's given us a thumbs down yet. I need at least one token thumbs down. Somebody must have hated the show tonight. So anyway, thank you guys for joining Jeff Gellman Seminars. Go there for our upcoming seminar series. And madly in love with you. And I care. Always remember to be nice. And thank you all for being here. Take care. Bye-bye.